Well, good afternoon and welcome to Campbellsville Baptist Church. My name is Brad Lauer, the discipleship pastor, and it is my honor and privilege to be here with you today as we study God's Word, as we explore these scriptures of God that He has had, that have stood the test of time, and as we look at His character and who He wants us to be by reading His Word. And so we're going to continue our study on the disciples, and we're on the second one that we're going to look at. We looked at Peter last time. We're going to look at James this time. And so we'll be all over Scripture a little bit, in Acts and Matthew and Luke and Mark, but we're going to look at the life of James. Let's go ahead and pray, and then we'll jump right in. God, we thank You for today and for Your grace and mercy. God, as we study Your Word, may we become more and more like You. Because God, every time we look at Your Word and we study Your Word, we gain a little bit more insight of who You are. And by doing that, then we are challenged to become more and more like You. So God, just continue to guide us as we study Your Word. In Jesus' name, amen. James, he's the older brother of John and a man on a mission to be somebody in this world. Most of us have a competitive side that drives us to do well or to be great. However, our competitive nature can tempt us to step on others along the way. So let's look at James, the brother of John, the older brother to John. So he's the older. And remember, James, John, and Peter are the inner circle of Jesus. And so they all thought they were somebody special. Remember, the mom of James came in and said, let him sit on the left and the right hand and all those kind of things. And so let's look at that. Let's look at an overview of who James is. He was always listed John, Peter, James, and John. You always hear them said that way. Peter, James, and John. Always listed to be second, but was out to be number one no matter what. No matter who he hurt or no matter who he made mad. Jesus never gave up on him, though. He rebuked him a few times, and he loved him to the end. And in the end, James died for Christ. He became the first disciple to be a martyr. The first one of the 12 to be a martyr for Christ. You can't count Judas. Judas went out and killed himself. And so let's look at Mark chapter 3, verses 16 and 17. If I can find it, here it is. And Jesus appointed the 12, Simon to whom he gave the name Peter, James the son of Zebedee, and John the brother of James, to whom he gave the name Boanerges, that is, sons of thunder. You always list the older brother first. And so James was the older brother. All rights, all customs were given to the firstborn. The firstborn carried the weight of the family. The firstborn son became the legacy of the family. And so he felt like he was entitled to be whatever. They were sons of thunder. If you look in Luke chapter 9, verses 51, I've got to find it here. It says, when the days drew near for him to be taken up, he set his face to go to Jerusalem, and he sent messengers ahead of him who went and entered the village of the Samaritans to make preparations for him. Am I reading the right thing? Yeah. But the people did not receive him because his face was set toward Jerusalem. And when his disciples James and John saw it, they said, Lord, do you want us to tell fire to come down from heaven and consume them? But he turned and rebuked them, Jesus did. And they went on to another village. The Samaritans and Jews were enemies. These were the sons of thunder. They were bold and brash and boisterous. The Samaritans did not want anything to do with anyone traveling to Jerusalem. They almost kind of like blocked their path. They just didn't want them to go. They wanted them to go around their area, their country. And so James and John remembered back in the Old Testament when somebody didn't want things to happen, Elijah called down for fire. He wanted to punish as Elijah did for not honoring God or not honoring Jesus. But Jesus said, no. He rebuked them because they had a loveless and vengeful attitude. Remember, James, I mean, remember Jesus had gone through Samaria before and had sat at a well and ministered to a lady. He ministered to a Samaritan woman who's an adulteress or whatever, and which was even more radical than some other things. And so now the disciples, these two disciples, these two brothers, James was like, no, these people need to be burned alive. They need to be depleted off the face of the earth. Elijah did this earlier. We need to do the same thing. But Jesus said, no, I'm here for love. I'm here for grace and for mercy. You see, and James wanted to win at any cost. If we flip back over to Mark chapter 10, you want to win at any cost. Let me see here. 10:35-45. And James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came to him and said to him, Teacher, we want you to do whatever for us. Let me try that again. Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask you. And he said to them, what do you want me to do? And they said, well, grant us to sit at one hand, right in the left hand in your glory. And Jesus said to them, you do not know what you're asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink or to be baptized with the baptism which I'm to be baptized? And they said, we are able. And Jesus said to them, the cup that I drink, you will drink. And with the baptism with which I am baptized, you will be baptized. But to sit at my right hand or my left hand is not mine to grant, but is for those whom it has been prepared. And when the ten had heard it, they began to be indignant towards James and John. And Jesus called them and said to them, you know that those who are considered rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them. But it shall not be among you, but whoever would be great among you must be your servant, and whoever would be first among you must be a slave of all. For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. And then in Matthew 20:20-21, then the mother of the sons of Zebedee came to him with her sons. And kneeling before him, she asked him for something. And he said to her, what do you want? And she said, say that these two sons of mine are to sit at your right and your left hand in your kingdom. You see, they thought Jesus was going to be an earthly king. They thought Jesus was going to be one to rule on earth. They thought Jesus was going to be lifted up above all and be powerful and overthrow the government. And they wanted to be at his right and his left hand, basically his next two commanders in chief or his next two people in charge. They wanted to be known and have prestige and to be lifted up and all those things. You know, this cup, this wrath. Baptism comes from flood or to destroy. You think about baptism. Think about when someone is baptized. It's basically a symbolic thing of death, to be baptized into the water, to go underneath, to be baptized meant to be flooded, to be immersed, to be dead. And so they were going to have to go through that baptism. James was always too ready to respond. And James was going to pay the ultimate price. He was going to be the first martyr to become of a follower of Jesus. He was going to be the first one to die, to be killed. His leadership in the end, James's leadership in the end, came from the sacrifice he made, his life. He paid the ultimate sacrifice, as we find in Acts chapter 12. Acts chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. About that time, Herod the king laid violent hands on some who belonged to the church. He killed James, the brother of John, with the sword. And when he saw that it pleased the Jews, he proceeded to arrest Peter. This was during the days of unleavened bread. But he killed James. James died because he was a follower of Jesus Christ, because he was the first disciple killed. Because of that, Herod Agrippa the First was the grandson of Herod the Great. Some thought he was the Messiah, so he persecuted the church until his death during the conversion of Saul. So we're just laying out everything we can tell about James. We're going to come back in a few minutes and apply all these and go through some principles that we learned. So let's also look at the life of James summarized. So we'll go into Matthew. I know it sounds like we're going along a long road around, but we want to get all this background first. Matthew chapter 4, verse 21 through 22. And going out from there, he saw two brothers, James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother John, in the boat with Zebedee, their father, mending their nets. And he called them. Immediately they left the boat and their father and followed him. He came from a family that ran a business. Other places in the scripture it talks about where they had multiple boats. They had a small business that had a fleet, maybe, and we don't know how many boats. But so he came from a family business. So he's used to being in charge. You know, like he was the oldest son, so he was next in line to take over the family business. So the dad was more than likely starting to turn over some of those responsibilities to him and having him lead some of the family business. He had a political connection. He knew the high priest in Jerusalem. If you look in John chapter, John chapter 18, verses 15. Simon Peter followed Jesus, and so did another disciple. Since that disciple was known to the high priest, he entered with Jesus into the courtyard of the high priest, but Peter stood outside at the door. So the other disciple who was known to the high priest went out and spoke to the servant girl who kept watch at the door and brought Peter in. And that was James. That was part of that family connection. He enjoyed privileges among the disciples. He was in the inner circle. So Jesus saw something special about him. You know, you have Peter, James, and John. He's always second, but he was part of the healing of Jairus' daughter. He was in that room. Not every disciple got to see that happen. He went and saw the transfiguration of Jesus as well. He was confused and puzzled by servant leadership. That made no sense to him because he was part of a family business. And dad told him what to do. He told others what to do. That's all there was to it. They didn't go and serve their employees. They told them what to do. And I believe he really, truly regretted falling asleep in Gethsemane while Jesus was praying. And then after the resurrection, James became one of the great leaders for that short period of time before he was killed as a disciple and as a leader. And so that's kind of the overview. We looked at a couple things. We looked at just kind of who he was. We looked at, you know, kind of his family makeup and his attitude and that he did make an ultimate sacrifice. Okay, but so let's look at a few things about his life that we have three principles we can look at that will help us understand how he plays a role, not just then, but how we can see it in our own lives and how we can apply it. Principle number one, no matter what our family background, Jesus can mold our lives into his image. There are a lot of problems in the family today. We can go and do all the research, but all we have to do is look out our window. All we have to do is go to a local establishment. All we have to do is go to church, and we can see that children are fatherless. Children don't even know who their dad is, or their dad has very limited access to the family. That's not the case with all, but there's a growing number where the father is not in the household. Now, the father may be invested in and spend time with, but the father may be distance, maybe a great distance away. And I understand that with my brother and his kids, and he's married, but his son has a different father from his wife's previous marriage, and that father moved away. And so my brother was able to become this child's dad, which is a neat story, and to watch my brother accept and take him in is really incredible. And I admire him so much for doing that. And through time, the boy's real father gave him up. My brother adopted him as his, and they changed his last name to be his last name. And so there's a neat story there of restoration for a child. But that boy does not really know his father. I remember working at Walnut Street when I was a student minister there, and many of the boys and girls that came into the youth ministry there from around the neighborhood in downtown Louisville, I knew their mom, I knew their grandmother, I knew their aunt, but they never mentioned their dad or their uncle or their grandfather. And so they grew up in homes without a male role model, and it was tough. You know, so many even have a father not being a good role model in their life. They didn't love their, they don't see their father loving their mother or loving their kids. When we have the love of Christ guiding them, the world will take notice. And in families, it's important that it comes together. And so James and John had a dad. Now, we don't know how much he loved or cared, but he was present. So no matter our family background, we can have a heart change. Maybe James's father was a hard man, business owner, and so it went not just during the day or when they were fishing, but at home as well. But families today, we need to embrace them and love them and reach out to families, no matter what that looks like, and help them the best we can, and to help create opportunities for them to be loved and cared for. Second principle is God is looking for dedicated men and women with natural leadership abilities who will become servant leaders. James probably followed Jesus in the beginning, thinking he was going to be the Messiah, as they thought. Because these were all good Jewish men. They understood what the Messiah was. They had read the prophecy. They had studied the Old Testament. They had heard it preached and taught by not only the priests, but their parents and generation after generation. And so Jesus saying he's the Messiah, and John the Baptist saying that he's the Messiah, that they thought he was going to rule. And so they followed him thinking, look at us. We're going to be a part of this new movement. We're going to be a part of a new kingdom. We're going to have really important roles, and we're going to be famous, and we're going to be wealthy, and we're not going to have to go out and fish anymore. We're going to do our own thing, and we're going to be this powerful, powerful person. So they used it as an opportunity to grow themselves into something for society to see. But God twisted it on them, especially on James, being the oldest, thinking he was in charge all the time. God wants to use our egos to achieve his goals. He wants to use that confidence and that pride and mold it and shape it and knock off a few levels of it sometimes, so that we will be able to go out and share, that we will be able to go out and reach people. Like James, being a business owner and a fisherman, he could reach people that Matthew, the tax collector, we'll talk about later, could not reach, and vice versa. James, with his personality, could had connections with the high priest. He could have an in different places, just like the way we grow up, just like the connections we make in life, give us the ability to minister to people differently than maybe somebody else around us can. So God wants to use all that to achieve his goals, not our goals. Also, we must allow God-centered energies to be molded by the Holy Spirit. In other words, we need to allow God to use who we are and to refocus what our abilities are and our energies to do what he has called us to do. If we're one who likes to, if our energies and focuses are on, let's say they're on sports, well, God can use that. God can use our love for sports to mold and shape many people around us. I'm not a very good coach, but God used me to coach and lead boys as my son was growing up, and girls as my daughter was growing up, as a coach. Whether it's baseball or basketball, my wife coached soccer, and so we were able to invest in the lives of kids and their families differently than I could saying that I'm a minister at this church, because I was out on the field running around with the kids and teaching them, yelling at them sometimes, but encouraging them, patting them on the back, praying with them, all those kind of things that I may never get to do because they may never come to the church, or I may not know them just being a minister, but because I invested in their lives on a daily basis, God used my energies to, you know, I always said that coaches have a special place because they get, they're inside the fence, and they get the opportunity to invest in the lives of those boys or those girls or those children on a regular basis, because you don't have much stronger relationships than you do with coaches, because you spend so much time with them. I remember growing up playing basketball all those years that my coach was somebody I looked up to and admired, or a teacher or whatever. So we have different ways that we're passionate about. A teacher can really invest in the lives of kids better than some others. my daughter looks up to her coaches, but also a couple teachers she's had over the years that have really impressed her onto what she may want to become later in life. Jesus wants to help us shed our self-centered pride and become humble but confident. We rely on God while using all the abilities God has given to us. We have to understand those gifts and abilities were not given to us by ourselves. They were given to us by God. Those passions, those desires, He has instilled those in us, and we're to use those to minister for Him, to go out and serve, to go out and teach, to go out and love, to go out and give. Those are the things that we've been given. Then the third principle, Jesus wants to use our competitive tendencies to build His kingdom, not our own. It is not wrong to do our best and be rewarded. Now, I'm under the belief that not everybody deserves a trophy. Not everybody deserves a participation ribbon. To me, that belittles and minimizes those who are better. I mean, there's a reason why some people are better. They're more talented, they work harder, whatever. And that's okay. But it's not wrong to do our best and be rewarded. And we should never be ashamed if we're succeeding or we're exceptional. Now, it's all in our attitude and our demeanor when we do that. It's not a bragging point. So motivation should be to honor and glorify God, not to bring glory and praise to ourselves. It should always be to be the external. Okay? It should be, I want to do my best because then I will give glory and honor to God. And you see that more and more in sports, and you wonder if they really mean it. Those guys who, when they score a touchdown and make a great play, they point up. Are they pointing up to God or to a relative or something? But it seems like maybe they're drawing to themselves. You know, Tim Tebow got criticized forever because when he scored a touchdown, he kneeled and he prayed. And people ridiculed him for that. He's just given up. And he hasn't changed over his time of being in the spotlight. He's always given honor and glory to God, and his lifestyle proves that that's his focus and not these other things. We must not lord over people our success or our place of authority. We've been put in a place of authority and a position of leadership because of gifts and abilities we have, but also because God has allowed it in a sense that we're there for a purpose. We're there to love people. Now, our personalities sometimes get in the way. Our demeanor sometimes gets in the way. But overall, we need to be able to share in love that way. James should give us hope because of where he began. He was raucous. He was angry. He was judgmental. He was self-centered and demanding. But he spent 3 years with Jesus. So sometimes doesn't happen overnight. Sometimes we believe we walk down front, we've accepted Christ in our bedroom, or somebody's led us to Christ, and we come down front, we make the decision public, and we go and we're baptized, and we think everything ought to be perfect. Well, James lived with Jesus for 3 years. It took more than 3 years for him to change. 3 years with an intimate relationship with Jesus changed his life. It takes time. A lot of those old behaviors and attitudes and personalities, they take a while to slowly change. You see, many of us are like James in some sense. We have pride. We have arrogance. We have judgmentalism. We're a little self-centered. We're a little demanding. But the more and more time we spend in here, the more and more time we spend with other Christians, the more and more time we spend in worship, the more and more time over time. Andy Stanley puts it this way. He says, small deposits over time make a difference. It's kind of how he puts it. In other words, if I will every day choose to make a small deposit of time in my spiritual walk with Christ, whether it's reading the scripture for 5 minutes or whether it's being on my knees for 3 or 4 minutes a day or both, and doing that a little bit every day over an amount of time, it adds up. I can't go on a binge reading. I can't go on a 24-hour prayer time and not pray for the other 364 days a year. So small deposits over time make a difference. Small deposits in my health make a difference. If I choose to exercise for 30 minutes, three or four times a week, over the years, it will make a huge difference. You can't go out and go run for 10 miles if you haven't run before and think that's going to help. It's going to be awful. I got to choose every day not to eat the cheeseburger, but to have the grilled chicken, or to choose the salad instead of the hash brown casserole or whatever. Small deposits on a daily basis make huge benefits down the road. So those are things that we have to look at. You know, so Jesus, it took 3 years of an intensity with Jesus for James to change. We don't have that luxury of being able to walk with Jesus physically. So we have to do a little bit every day. We have to do some things every day to focus on our relationship with Christ, and we will change. We will become more and more like Him. God, we thank You that today is a day that we can start making small deposits in our relationship with You. We can spend a few moments every day with You, only with You for those few moments and not distracted. And over time, the benefits will continue to grow. So God, may we do that. May we choose that today, to start today to do that. And God, guide us as we continue to live our lives, that it will be one that honors You and glorifies You and brings praise to You, that when people see us living our life on a daily basis, they go, something special about their life. There's something different about their life. I wonder what it is. Let me ask them. And then we have the opportunity to share. So God, guide us today as we honor You with our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. So thank you for being with us today. I hope that you've learned something from James, as he has been one that changed a lot from being this boisterous, arrogant person to calming down a little bit and then paying the ultimate sacrifice. I challenge you to make a small deposit in your physical, in your spiritual lives, and in your relationships each and every day. Just small deposits. They don't have to be huge, but they have to be something. And they have to be consistent, and they have to be regular. We can't binge run. We can't starve ourselves for a couple days to change our health. We can't read the Bible in 3 days thinking that it will be the best for us. And so make a commitment to do something little each and every day in your personal, in your relational life, in your physical life, and in your spiritual life. May God continue to guide you as you journey with Him. And we want to invite you to come be a part of us here at Campbellsville Baptist Church as we worship together at 9 and 11 on Sunday mornings. Invest in your spiritual walk. We're on the air at 11. If you need to watch us on TV, you can watch us at 11. And we do this Bible study program every week so that you have another investment that you can make on a weekly basis. But we'd love to have you here in person so that we can connect on a more intimate level as we wrap our arms around one another, as we join together in worshiping and studying God's Word, and then building relationships with one another. And so, call us if you need us, 465-8115, or you can email me at bradl@sevobaptist.com. We would love to hear from you. May God continue to guide you as you journey with Him today.